Hello everyone, thank you for joining us. Today we are running a third webinar of the Reflections on MEC. I'm Anna Kassa and I am Educator Advisor and MEC Coordinator here at Moodle HQ. And with me I have Vaida Holohan, Tahia Bagol and Christine Hollis from Enovation, Certified Service Provider. Our facilitators will share a little bit from their perspectives as MEC facilitators and will introduce later four of their candidates who are the guest stars of this event. Candidates are going to share their own experiences and tell us what impact MEC made in their lives. This session is more like a roundtable, so you have the chance to pose your questions to our guests. Just before we get there, let me give you a quick introduction of what is and what is not the Moodle Educator Certificate. The MEC is an international certificate for teaching with Moodle, and it is offered exclusively by authorized Moodle certified service providers. Be careful, because the MEC is not a basic Moodle training. No. And it's not even an advanced Moodle training. In fact, it's not a training at all. It's a certification process focused on meeting learners' needs with Moodle. And it requires that candidates have at least 1 year of real life experience in teaching with Moodle. MEC certification consists of 6 courses. Be careful, not training courses, but 6 certification courses that lead to 6 badges. And once someone has all these badges, is eligible for the MEC certificate. Now, you might wonder why 6 courses? The answer is very easy. We have 6 courses and 6 badges because the MEC is based on the European Framework for the Digital Competence of Educators. Perhaps you may know it as DigiComEdu. This framework organizes educators' professional and pedagogic competencies, as well as learners' competencies into 6 areas. These are the professional engagement area, the teaching and learning area, the digital resources, the assessment, the empowering learners, and the facilitating learners' digital competence area. Overall, this framework contains 22 competencies organized in these 6 areas. And if we take a closer look, we can see, for example, that in the teaching and learning area, that we talk about collaborative learning, self-regulated learning, teaching, and guidance. So the question when it comes to MEC is, how do we apply all this in Moodle? And that is what candidates need to answer. As mentioned before, MEC is offered exclusively by Moodle certified service providers. So when you join a provider to take the MEC, you will be registered in the MEC site and you will be allocated to the MEC program as shown here. Note that all MEC courses have the same structure. So let's take a closer look at one of them. Let's see the teaching and learning course. On the top of this course, there is the welcome section with the announcements forum and the How This Course Works book that summarize all the basic information about the course. In the second section, we have the What Do You Already Know? And there is a self-assessment check-in here. This is a quiz based on the Selfie for Teachers. Selfie for Teachers is a well-known self-assessment tool for teachers, especially around Europe. This quiz has been designed for teachers so they can evaluate where are they standing at on specific competencies. The third section is the teaching and learning overview. Actually, is the overview section, and here we have mainly books and quizzes. The books explain the competence and contextualize them within Moodle. It's not about how Moodle works and how to set up Moodle activities or resources. It just explains which tool can be used to achieve this competence. The books are always accompanied with a quiz to help candidates confirm their understanding. The number of the books and their quiz depend on the number of the competencies existing in Cherry. So in MEC courses, we may have 3, 4, or 5 pairs of books and quizzes. Here we have a book and a quiz for teaching, for guidance, for collaborative learning, and for self-regulated learning. The next session is called Your Assessed Tasks and is the place where the actual assessment is happening. Here we have 2 assignments and candidates need to write and submit both of them. Each of the assignments must have between 500 to 800 words, and candidates need to answer specific questions and offer solutions in real life problems based on their own experiences. Candidates can include screenshots of courses they have created and offered. They can also include the link to a course, giving the facilitators permissions to access, of course. Candidates can resubmit twice after the first grading and feedback. And the pass grade is set at B2 level. Now, what is B2? Assignments are evaluated with a rubric, like the one we see here. Vertically are the 4 competencies, and horizontally you can see the levels that vary from A to B1, B2, C1, and C2. Now, if you are familiar with the Common European Framework Reference, Common European Framework of Reference for Languages, you will recognize this ABC scale of basic, independent, and proficient user. At A1, we have users who can interact in a simple way, and at C2, we have the users who can talk fluently and precisely. And these are usually interpreters and translators. So the same levels are used in the DigiCom Edu, and that's why we have adopted them and used them here in the MEC. So if you're standing at levels A1, A2, then it's too soon for you to think about the MEC. You still need some experience. You might even need some training. If you are at level B1, then perhaps you're a good candidate to start with MEC, as this would mean that you are a regular user, but perhaps you haven't considered those competencies in detail. If you are at level B2, then we have certainly a pass for the MEC, as you would be an expert. And if you're standing at level C1, it means that you're already a leader. And if you are at C2, then you are an innovator, a top trainer. Last not least, before I leave the floor to our guests, I would like to inform you that MEC is already offered in 7 different languages. It is fully translated in English, Spanish, French, Portuguese, Chinese, Japanese, and Arabic. And there are more translations to come, such as Catalan and German. And it is very easy to take the MEC in any of these languages. All you need to do is to change the system language from the drop-down menu on top of the page. In the MEC site, this change will result to the change of language both for the system and the content. And that's all for me. Let's move on now to our MEC facilitators and the guests. Baida, Tahia, and Christine, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Anna. Thank you for the introduction. And we are delighted to be here today and share our MSc experiences. So first of all, just to set the context, a few words about Enovation. We are a premium Moodle partner with offices in Ireland, in France, and in Poland. And we consider ourselves a one-stop shop for all things e-learning, and our services range from a consultancy, custom development, hosting, support and maintenance and content development. And the last, but not the least, would be training. So we do offer training for site administrators and course creators, as well as we offer MSc certificate together with Moodle headquarters. Basically we have a team of four facilitators and two in Ireland and two in France. And that means that we can facilitate MSc in two languages. So that brings it, perhaps closer to home for a lot of users. And it makes us stand out a little bit. I have been involved with the MSc right from the very beginning, and I saw how it evolved and how it changed and how now it provides a possibility for any Moodle educator around the world to explore various ways, tools, and methods that can be used. And also, I think, explore the all existing possibilities. And also, I think the MSc pushes us all out of comfort zone a little bit, because it challenges and makes us think why we do things the way we do things. So I think that the webinar title, Reflections on MSc, is very fitting. So while now we are reflecting on MSc and our experiences in MSc course, when we are doing MSc, I think we are reflecting on our teaching practice. Because when you know why you do things the way you do them, the how-to becomes only just configuration and setup. So it's not really that complicated, and we all know how to configure tools within Moodle, and we can find online help. But this gives us a possibility of sharing the knowledge between the Moodle community and seeing what tools can be used in which contexts. So I'm delighted to be here today, and I have to say that my knowledge of Moodle and all the various tools keeps expanding, and that I learn from and together with the students of MSc. And now I will let my colleagues Taya and Christine to introduce themselves.
I'm delighted as well to be here today. I'm Christine Frelich. This is a very complicated name when you pronounce it in English. And I work at Enovation France as a digital learning project manager. As Vaida said, actually we do a little bit of everything, and particularly we follow clients in their Moodle project. We do training, and we follow also candidates in their MEC certification. So I'm also MEC facilitator since September 2021. It's quite recent. And actually, I don't want to repeat what Vaida said, but it's quite the same. As a trainer and a teacher that I used to be, MEC has been a good experience for me, because I've discovered lots of functionalities I didn't think of before, and mainly because I had to think properly about what I do, or what I did, or what I would have done with Moodle. As a facilitator, it gives me the opportunity to discover how people, how trainer, how teacher work with Moodle, how they think, what is their pedagogy. And this is very important in this way. I think it's Taya then.
Yeah, hello everyone. So I'm Taya Bagod. I'm in charge of the training in the customer support for our Moodlers. And as an instructor, I also create courses with Moodle and Moodle Workplace. I'm working at Enovation Bordeaux in France since October 2020. Until then, I had to pass the MEC and also become a facilitator. And it was a bit challenging for me, not only regarding the program that covers such wide competencies, but also because the French translation wasn't yet available. So with other French partners, Moodle partners, I participated to the translation of this program, and it's such more comfortable to facilitate it now that it's in my own language. So thank you, Moodle, for doing this. And that's it for me.
So now our guests, it would be great if you could introduce yourselves.
Yeah, hi, and my name is Martin Kelly. I work for the Irish Wheelchair Association, which is a voluntary organisation in Ireland, throughout Ireland. We work with people with disabilities, and we also train people that in the care sector, and we use Moodle for that reason. From my own background, I was a regional and national trainer for 10 years. And then with the Irish Wheelchair Association, and after that I became team lead of that team, where we had about 8 staff members, including one of your guests, Darko, who were regional trainers, and we used Moodle to bring in e-learning and blended learning throughout the organisation, which naturally came in exceptionally important during COVID-19, during the lockdowns. So yeah, that's me. Thanks very much.
Martin already introduced the organization and myself. So yes, I work in Irish Wheelchair Association as a regional trainer. So yes, how I use Moodle. I use Moodle on a daily basis. Prior to completing MEC course, I didn't have much knowledge, only as a student. So it was a little bit overwhelming and maybe challenging with finding time to complete it. But I have to say, I did benefit quite a lot from it because, as Martin already mentioned, most of our courses sit on Moodle now. So how I would use it is, apart from tracking, you know, students' progress and all, we would transfer all our face-to-face courses. They sit on Moodle now. So it's not just about building it. It's how do we teach and how people learn in Moodle. So I would just have to say one thing, that it offers so much. So there's a huge potential there in completing MEC course. But I would recommend to everyone not to feel overwhelmed by that. Maybe use the scaffolding approach to it. So what I would do is, depending on my learners and depending on the course content, I would introduce certain tools and certain resources, you know, that would suit that particular group. So there's no need to panic and pack it up with everything. So you can just start with chat, forum, you know, assessment before you move into, you know, I would at the moment use feedback, chat, forum, assessment, where you might have different group of learners with a different course where you might want to introduce database, assignments, etc. So I have benefited quite a lot from it because I don't want to talk too much here, but I just want to say something else. I have went on and completed the blended learning course after MEC, and I found it really beneficial there, where part of the program was to build a course and see how you can teach even at higher level. And I found a lot of people are still playing with Moodle Sandbox, where I was quite able to not only build a course, but understand every resource and every tool that's available there. So that would be me, and I'm happy to answer any questions afterwards if anybody has anything to ask. Thank you.
I am pedagogy and multimedia advisor, office software and multimedia trainer in ACPM. ACPM is an association created 60 years ago now in the south of France. We are located in the Alpes-Côte d'Azur region. We cover all the south of France. We offer training in the fields of mercant marine, electricity, catering, digital as well, as program as for migrants and the people coming from difficult neighborhoods. We use a model both to offer training course and blended learning with more of technical theory contents, but also to try to develop multimodality and learning autonomy of trainings with difficult access. We use assessment, difficult courses, and all the aspect of Moodle to introduce modality in our association.
Hi, thanks for having me. My name is Keith Byrne. I am the Waterford or Wexford or WWETB IT instructor and Moodle administrator. So I use Moodle and from both sides of the coin. So in terms of, I would use it to set up blank courses for other instructors to use, but I also use it myself to create content. Because my learners, I look after a multimedia room. My learners come in, it's flexible learning, part-time, and they come in and they self-study or independent learning using a mixture of online resources. Some stuff that we get from providers and some stuff that I actually create myself. So I use Moodle quite a lot. And I suppose I did the MEC just towards the end of my master's. I was doing a master's in teaching and learning, which I completed last year. And I was building course content on Moodle for the master's. And it was an extension of that. And I use quite a lot of Moodle features. And I think it's interesting what the other people said about learning what you use the features for and why you use them and the reasons why you use them. Because it's a bit like a Rubik's Cube as such. There are many different ways and solutions of using some of these tools. And just because you can doesn't mean that you should. Okay, there has to be a reason behind why you use them. And you'll work out as well what works for your learners. And just because there's a nice new feature has been released in the latest version of Moodle doesn't mean that it'll actually work straight off the bat. So understanding what the pedagogical methods underpinning the resource that you're using is very important. So that's me, and I'm happy to answer any questions if anybody's stuck on anything.
Thank you very much. So I think just from the very beginning, let's start with the positives, and maybe you could tell us what you have benefited most. What was something that, you know, you thought, okay, I wouldn't have known this without the MSc?
In terms of what I found most beneficial, as I said, I would be quite familiar with most of the tools within Moodle. But what I found most beneficial for me in terms of, because I do a lot of administration, I would help other instructors to understand how to build content online, and especially the likes of the tracking student progress. So being able to implement stuff like checklists, course progression, doing sections, and knowing the difference between the different layouts that Moodle have. Most people use the default to never change it. And to be able to explain to somebody, look, there's a social format, there's a topics format, so they know what the difference is between them. Because that's a very big thing. It's a bit like, you know, you take a device out of the box and you keep it on the default and you never change the settings. And if you don't explore the settings, you really don't understand the full amount of what the device can do. And that's the way I see Moodle. You know, if they understand every little bit of it, then they'll know what to use and why and when. And that's the most important thing that I found beneficial out of the MEC.
Yeah, I'd like to actually, if you don't mind, I'd like to just jump in and say that he put that very clearly. I think what the course does overall is that it gives you an in-depth knowledge of the capabilities of Moodle, something that I wouldn't have had beforehand, because in a very similar way, we had a very basic, we made very basic changes to the kind of, I suppose, the background and the look of it. But that's all we did. But when I did the MEC, I found out there was an awful lot more available to me in terms of assessment options, like Keith was saying, progress of students, and also just the way that you actually plan out your learning. And I think even though it's online and even though it has many capabilities, like in technical terms, it also brings it back to the way people learn as well, and in digestible chunks, and something that people can tick off. I found the broader kind of capabilities of Moodle were there, but I just didn't realize that they were there. When I did the MEC, yeah, it all became a little bit clearer for me.
For me, Middle, the MEC forced me to take a step aside and take another posture, get out the geek and the IT technician posture. And it's comfortable and move from the administration of a platform and have to have a reflection on what to do and what I do and really wonder about the meaning and what the sense of all the quotidian and about the form and not the technical.
Definitely, I think it makes sense because while doing MSc, you have time assigned to reflecting back on what you are actually doing. So you think, okay, I'm doing it in the same way for the last, 5 years, but is it actually the correct and the best way to do it? So you could explore additional features that you can, implement and then gathering feedback and understanding how your learners react to it. I think it's a little bit like taking this holistic approach to teaching online, isn't it? You have to plan, then you gather feedback, then you see how it works. And I think maybe any Moodle course is perfect. It's a journey. We're all on a journey of learning how to implement and what to implement and in what contexts. Okay.
The process.
Yeah, it's about the process, exactly. What was most challenging? Could you tell us what was kind of unexpected and when you thought, I didn't think about that? Were there any challenges that you faced?
It took more time than I initially thought, the course. And maybe I should have had a little bit more thought about that before I took it on, because I took it on at an exceptionally busy time. I remember it well. But I think if I had advice to anybody, or if I known beforehand, is that just how much time that it takes up and how thorough it is, because it does go through the details. And it's there are some parts where you kind of think may not be that important, but you do find out later on that they are. So I think if I was advising anybody to do it, I would, because I think it was an amazingly worthwhile course to do. I would say just to build that into your time, build that into your calendar, to give yourself time to actually sit down and concentrate on the topics and the badges, each badge separately. Because you do need that little bit extra space to clear your head and just think of that. But that's the advice I think I probably give to somebody. I wish I'd known it, but that was my own fault, not yours.
No, that's understandable. I think you have to assign time for it, like you say. When I was doing a course, somebody said you get out of it what you put into it. So you have to actually put in the time, put in the effort to explore all those resources that are available for you, and then reflect on your own teaching practice. And like you mentioned, even something that you might think might not be relevant, I'm never going to come across it. Next week, you will come across it and you think, oh, I actually know what's being talked about here, So yeah, that's great. Keith, what was challenging for you?
I suppose in terms of the course material, I reiterate what Martin was saying there. It does take a bit of time to go through it, especially if you're not that familiar with it. It's not something that should be taken lightly. You do have to have a good understanding of the basics. As was said, it's not a basics Moodle course. There is quite a lot in depth in it. Now, in terms of my own context, in terms of what I find most challenging is pushing it out to the wider community. It's a slow burn within my organization here. We certainly, because we're further ed, we're quite restricted. And there is an awful lot of kind of you know, unsure on the technologies. There's a couple of people who might not be au fait with technology. You've a couple of people who just, no matter what you say to them, won't learn the technology if you ask them to. And then you get other people who are all for it and just don't have the time to do it. So you get a lot of kind of a slow build up in terms of trying to promote it within the organization. And that would be my biggest challenge with it, is not the course itself. It's trying to promote it to my colleagues and saying, look, this is an excellent course. You will learn how to do all of these things that you can bring in either face-to-face learning or online or blended. Whereas most people just see as the IT as being online blended, but you can actually bring in these things into a class, face-to-face class as well. So that would be my biggest challenge, is trying to push it out amongst my colleagues.
For me, the more challenging was to feed my reflection with my experience and not to stay academic. And it was very hard on the beginning not to put only something very theoretical and to take the risk to bring all my my feed, my experience, my cursus, and always put it and both MEC and me to complete all this to progress. And the challenge all along the journey was this for me.
Yeah, I have to 100% agree with both Martin and Keith. It's the organization sometimes can be challenging to, you know, to promote that amongst your colleagues, and you're quite restricted like that, what Keith was saying about technology. So we, for example, would have this in our strategy for every trainer to have completed MEC in the next 2 years. And yet there's still reluctancy there. So I'm the only one on the team at the moment with it. So you're trying to kind of convince people how, but I think they got a bit of a feedback that it is challenging with your time. You know, you really have to spend time on this, and yet people will use the excuse of, you know, I'm not that IT kind of savvy IT. And even I would find, for example, like digital resources or licensing parts in the MEC, it was not something I would have thought about that much before. So I would have found that a bit challenging. So you really have to spend time and you know, try to understand all that. So yeah, 100% I agree. And it's sometimes it's not really us or yourselves. It's the organization that's reluctant to change.
I think in some ways, perhaps MSC gives you the tools to champion that knowledge, you know, to share that knowledge, because it is, a lot of it is focused on collaboration and sharing the knowledge within your organization, sharing the knowledge with the Moodle community. So as you are doing now, so I think definitely you are, you know, on the right track, and it's a slow process, but it's going to happen.
Yeah.
Okay. Just wondering if your teaching has changed in any ways. Do you have any practical examples, perhaps?
Yeah, I have to say, I know this might sound very simple, but I love the fact that there's no printing and accumulation of emails. There's no assessments in the classroom, so you can actually have the assessments on the Moodle, self-corrected with multiple choice, you know, questions, and then those that are open-ended questions, you have to correct them. I was actually doing some corrections this morning, and I just love the fact that everything sits in one place, provides a automatic feedback to people, much easier. And I know this is something so simple, it's not all about, you know, teaching, but even that aspect of Moodle, it really benefited me big time.
I think I just, yeah, again, because I would have worked with Darko up till about 6 months ago, I part of doing the MEC, part of the good thing about doing the MEC is that it opens up your possibilities, and that would change your the way you train and the way you teach completely. And it is like what Darko was saying. Unfortunately, I don't work on the team anymore, but unfortunately, if more people in the team had done the MEC, which I really would encourage people to do, that it would expand their horizons, I suppose, on the teaching front, because it gives you so many options. So it is almost like when you do the MEC, you almost want to go back and rewrite all your training programs. And that could be a good thing and a bad thing, okay? Because it can take you a lot of time to rewrite the training programs. But in the positive side of that is that in so many different ways, when you have that knowledge of after doing the MEC, it saves money for the organization, it saves time, it saves, you know, like Darko said, people want to become, you know, paperless now, and it has all those benefits. So, but like we said, if you don't do the MEC, you don't see that, because, you know, what you see, I mean, I often, when you see other people's Moodles, I'm sorry if I'm rabbiting on now, but often when you see other people's versions of Moodle, you get a bit jealous of what they look like, and you want to go back and you want to try and copy there, which is great, because it is a community, you know, that you learn from each other. But if people don't do the MEC, they don't have the knowledge of how to do that. So that is something that is really important, I think. And it does, I absolutely would say, hand on heart, that it definitely does change your outlook on teaching when you do the MEC, for sure.
I'll reiterate that as well. It definitely does change the way you kind of approach your course design, approach your teaching of your classes. It really does make you think. It's definitely more student focused. I think a lot of people, when they haven't done the MEC, see it as kind of an IT thing, and, you know, that's an IT job, and it doesn't really benefit me, and it doesn't really benefit my students. And you're kind of going, well, first of all, it shouldn't be about you at all. It should be about what your students are looking for. We're supposed to be student-centered. That's one of our philosophies. So therefore, what does your student expect? What does your student want? And giving your student choices. And that's what the MEC does. And it very much ties in with UDL principles. I've done a lot of stuff on universal design for learning, and also on instructional design principles. So certainly after doing the MEC, I looked down both sides, and I've done certification both in UDL and in instructional design, and they really tie in with the whole MEC. And it really does give you a completely new way of thinking about what resources you're going to use, how you're going to tie it all together, and the learning experience that your student gets when they're in the classroom or they're online using these resources. And that would be the biggest change for me.
First, two essential reasons. The consideration of inclusion and accessibility with trainees, and the importance of more spaces for the expression of trainees, space for communities, for forum surveys, and more spaces for communities in Moodle. Not only a space for journeys, parcours, as we say in France, but a space where people can also exchange.
That's very important. So nearly kind of creating a community around the subject matter, isn't it? And yeah, being able to ask the questions and learn from each other. It, like you say, it is student focused, and it doesn't have to be so one-sided teacher just training students. Students can learn a lot from each other, and creating that possibility for them to work on projects, to have discussions, definitely it's very, very beneficial and engaging. Has your roles changed after completing MSc, or do you see that maybe you were given more responsibilities within your organizations? Is there any comment on that?
I suppose my role has kind of got a lot more busier because I completed my MEC, I think, just before COVID really hit. And when COVID kind of hit, then everybody was looking to get online and, you know, put content up. And I suppose one of the things is to try and get through to people that, you know, it's not an online repository, Moodle. It's not, there's, you know, 10 pages of notes and, you know, that's online learning. You know, so my role has changed in terms of that way. And I've done kind of a series of videos for staff on the likes of how to use marking rubrics or how to use a workshop for self-assessment and peer assessment, stuff like that. So to allow students and teachers to see the benefits of everything that Moodle can offer, because most people just see it as I said, a big online filing cabinet. And I'm sure that the other lads who have done the MEC will say the same thing, that, you know, most people, when they haven't really explored the functionalities of Moodle for establishing, you know, social learning, as you said, with forms and Q&A forms, this sort of stuff, that all they see is, oh yeah, you can upload a document. Sure, we have a website for that. Sure, why would we need Moodle? And it's to actually explain to them, no, this is what Moodle can do for you. I know with regards to our own organization, a lot of our own organization use Microsoft Teams, which has some really good features, but it can't do all the assessment stuff that Moodle can do. And to explain the difference between the VLE, which is Moodle, and something like Microsoft Teams, you can't compare the two products together. They're two different products. They have two different ways of functioning, and they have different ways of doing things. And certainly the VLE is the way to go, in my view, because you can track your students, have everything in the grade book. And I just find it so easy to use. And it's just getting enough people on board to do the likes of the MEC. It's definitely worthwhile doing to get all these skills.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay. I'm just wondering, I guess, kind of to summarize it, and you have given some tips for other learners, but is there any advice that you could give? Is there anything else that you would like to single out?
Yeah, well, I just wanted to say something on the last point with Kira. I do have to say the role did change for me as well, as much as it's good. So I can see track the progress of students and made certain things easier. It also gave me more work. So I'm on Moodle every day now because, as I said earlier, I'm the only one on the team with this. So I still have colleagues ringing me, you know, oh, can you please show me this, show me that, you know, so it's like, in that sense, it's kind of changed to I'm busier with it. But on another hand, I've definitely benefited from being able to, you know, to have everything in one place. I would definitely recommend a course to any kind of trainer, teacher, anybody that's in learning environment. I would highly recommend the MEC course.
Yeah, my role has actually changed, and I work in schools. And when I see other people's Moodles, just you wonder why the structure is the way it is, and if they had done the MEC, the structure might be better, if you know what I mean. The design of their training might have been better. But yeah, that's all I wanted to say, yeah.
According to, for me, I would say have fun first and take a break and do not transform the trip into a race to the badge only, but take a step aside and take the time to reach all your practice with all the contents, with all the assessments. There is very, very things. And have contacts or more of our contacts, not the good one, with your facilitator. It's a very good engine to progress all along the journey.
That's great. Anybody else would like to add anything?
Yes, just as facilitator, I saw that if you begin by the course that you feel the most comfortable with, you will come in the program and it will be easier to do the other courses that covers other competencies that you are not...
not familiar.
Yeah. Yep. So it's a bit challenging for everyone. So take it easy and begin by the first step, your first step.
That's a really good point. So instead of getting overwhelmed and say, oh, this is not familiar to me, start with something which is familiar and build it like building blocks nearly, isn't it?
Yeah.
That's a very good point.
If you're looking for kind of advice for those kind of undertaking it, one of the best things you can do is actually play with a blank course, play around with what's available. So creativity is a big part of it. And it's probably the most fun that I enjoy out of doing the job in terms of the instructional design side is actually the creative element. There are many different solutions to many different issues that you encounter in the classroom in terms of bridging the learning gap. So having a kind of a blank course to play around with, even after the MEC is finished, to play around with something. I want to experiment. This might work as a game, or this might work as an interactive book or something like that. Play around with it before you release it, and then release it and see how it lands, and see then do I need to tweak it. So that would be my biggest advice, actually. Play around with what's there. Don't just read it and go, oh, well, I know that's theory. Actually get to grips with it. Go in and play with the different options.
Yeah. Great advice, indeed.
Yeah, that's a great point, because you are in a safe environment then. So you can, I always say to my kind of students to create test users and test it, see what experience is like from a user point of view. When you are setting up and reading it, you know how it should work, but does it really work the way it does? And I guess involving your colleagues and piloting nearly some elements or some activities and seeing how it works in real life, what is the experience and what's really, what benefits it brings?
Yeah, hello, okay. I'm Cecile. Can I speak?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I have been teaching math at university level for 20 years, and I'm using Moodle since 3 years now. It is a really simple developing Moodle files, and it's really easy to integrate the package within LaTeX. And it helps me to, why I use Moodle, it helps really to make the students train themselves during the courses, to make them participate actively, and for the teacher to have feedback on what they really understand. And it can be also a tool for testing them at the end and in the middle, in between also. Moodle is really an e-learning material efficient for cognitive psychology. It changes the approach of teaching. It opens for new ways of thinking, expand the horizon of ideas, and helps creativity. And it is a facilitator for having discussions within the courses. And so it is a communication facilitator and a positive training that helps shy students to participate. And that is, I think, the most principal, four points. So the benefits for teachers are a new pedagogical approach. They it helps to make a course progression and helps feedback and test. And for the students, I think it helps them participate actively and concentrate on the courses and progress during the courses. And it's a funny e-learning device and well, a technology, a good e-learning technology, I think.
Thank you, Cecilia, for your feedback. Unfortunately, we often find that a lot of educators or trainers and people who use Moodle don't have the experience you describe, because they just often upload a couple of files, give a quiz, and that's the end of story, without monitoring users, without supporting learning, without managing a class, without building a community of inquiry within an e-learning course, without being able to do that, actually. And this is where MEC fits. So MEC goes beyond the Moodle training, the Moodle how-to, and it touches questions on how can I support learners with disabilities? How can I collaborate better with my colleagues and stuff like that? So yeah, eventually we want all educators to have experience like the one you described, but unfortunately this is not the case, and MEC is just a step towards this direction. I hope it helps that way. At least that was our intentions when we build MEC as a certification process. And I think the only ones that can really answer this if we reach a goal are our guests today, Keith, Darko, and Mark, and I lost someone, and Martin. today, so if we actually helped, if we actually empowered educators, took them one step forward to quality education with Moodle.
Yeah, it certainly from my point of view, it has empowered me. As I said, I was fairly okay with the technology anyway before doing the MEC. I was fairly familiar with an awful lot of it. But in terms of where it's kind of left me, it's certainly given me confidence going forward, because the way I see it is you're future-proofing. You know, this is going to be the way learning is going to be done into the future. So it's a way of future-proofing not only your skills, but also your content for your learners going forward, because content goes out of date quite quickly. And if all you're doing is uploading a couple of documents, you'll find that people are kind of getting quite bored with them quite quickly. Whereas if you're learning more in depth, how to do more social learning, forum postings, blogging, if you're learning how to do interactivity using like H5P plugins, which are all really easy to use, you'll find that they'll last longer, because it'll be longer in use, because people get more benefit from it from a pedagogical point of view.
Thank you. Anyone else? Darko?
Yeah, I agree as well with Keith. Definitely empowered me, and I would try to empower other people. And now, as I said, people are reluctant, but because it's in our strategy, so I can see this is the way forward. So all other trainers will have to eventually complete this over the next couple of years, hopefully, you know, just because it would broaden their kind of, you know, just open mind about how we actually teach, how can we, you know, support learners, how can we make things. And what you find very interesting there, what Keith said, is things do go out of date. So, you know, interesting he mentions there, H5P. You know, when I came across that first, I was like, oh my God, what's this? I'm not that familiar with it. But when you actually realize and learn, yeah, how easy it's to use. And even then at the start, if I'm honest, I was a bit afraid. How do I, you know, the way you always analyze, you always think of your learners. How will my learners take this? Oh my God, they won't be able for it. But as I said earlier, scaffolding bit by bit, step by step, you know, and if all the trainers within my team are on the same page, we would easily be able to introduce something like that. And as Keith said, that's lasts forever. Like, you know, it's kind of easier to for people to remember as well, you know, rather than just uploading files. So, yeah, I would empower definitely others to complete the course as well. Yeah.
Thank you. Martin?
You know, I would just be repeating what the other two guys said, really. I have nothing new to bring to the table, but I agree with everything they said there. Yeah, I mean, it's interesting what Keith was saying, because a lot of our stuff does go out of date quite quickly because we deal with policy and updating different kind of policies that come in and change quite frequently. And also the point about future-proofing, really. It is... You know, everybody, I think everybody realizes that it is the future. It's not only the future, it's the present, really, for you know, people that are on this track. But it is definitely going to become more and more part of learning, regardless of what part of the education system that you're in. So, yep, I agree with everything they're saying. Yeah.
Thank you. Zamari?
Yes, I agree with all this. I think... training is a piece of a global strategy with growing interactivity communities and the place of citizens in the society of today's society and digital. And I think that Moodle is not only a piece of content, but is a place where people meet to build project and become and transform society and their vision and themselves.
Thank you so much for sharing your stories and inspiring others to go through the MEC. As we wrap up, I want to ask a question to our audience. Are you ready for the MEC? What do you think? You may easily find an accurate answer, you know, in this question simply by taking the pre-placement quiz in the Are You Ready for the MEC section of the scores. Depending on your score in this quiz, you will find guidelines on how to proceed. So you will know if you are ready to take the MEC right away or if you need to come back at a later stage after getting some training from the academy or from your extended network of certified service providers. Or perhaps if you need to gain some more experience in teaching with Moodle. So if you have enjoyed this session and Moodle Academy, you may consider getting involved further and help us grow by contributing to its development. Being in the Academy, you can be an active member, you can suggest topic ideas, what would you like us to see covering in the future? You can join the Get Involved course and make your own suggestions, ask the subject of your interest, vote for the subjects that have been already suggested. And you can also contribute to the webinars if you have particular skills. If you are an expert on a subject and you have something interesting to say, just let us know. Note that the webinar presenters will gain a presenter's badge from the academy, and you can also contribute to courses and by sharing your experience and contributing to the development of courses, and this will let you gain a course builder badge. And of course, please help us spread the word about Moodle Academy and MEC. Tell your friends and your colleagues about the courses offered and the fact that they lead to badges. Don't forget to take the Are You Ready for the MEC quiz? And if you are ready, contact one of our certified service providers to support you through the certification process. Thank you very much. And it was a pleasure to having you here today. See you in the next webinar.